On August 3rd, 1874, I was born and given father's name. From my pictures, I was fat and round-faced, the usual run of a baby. In April 1876, father contracted scarlet fever, and on May 1st, 1876, he passed away. This was a terrible shock to mother, faced with the future bringing up of six children. A week or two before father was stricken with scarlet fever, he wrote a beautiful note of his deep affection for mother. Mother kept it all her life. This letter and the memory of their 3 years together gave her courage during the 30 years following father's death. I remember Thanksgiving dinner at Grandmother Stevens in her house on Academy Road with her 28 grandchildren and their families. Of course, turkey was the main dish, and there were several being carved by the older members to supply the 45 to 50 persons that were waiting with large appetites for the feast. There was no ice cream, but the plum pudding was excellent, flanked by five kinds of pie: apple, squash, mince, lemon, and Marlborough. The last had a sort of street appearance. After the dinner was over, the big event of the day was the giving to each one of her grandchildren a $5 gold piece by grandmother, who sat on the sofa on one side of the parlor, flanked by her daughters and daughters-in-law, with her sons and sons-in-law in the background. Then opposite her, arranged in a semicircle around the room, were her grandchildren according to their ages. When we were all lined up, Cousin Ned would march up to grandmother and she would hand him a $5 gold piece. He would kiss her and return to the line. Then Hattie would do the same thing and so on down the line until they reached me. I would toddle up, and being a fat little fellow, I have a distinct recollection of their laughing when I marched up and back. In the 1880s, Mother ran a small farm. We had three horses as a rule, and we always kept a cow and a pig in the barn cellar. A vegetable garden supplied us during the summer, and the rest of the field below the barn was cut for hay. We had a hired man to do the work, Frank Gavin, who presided over the place for many years. As a very small boy, I would follow him around, and after a while he would say to me, "If you don't get out of my way, I will grease your ears and swallow you." Father and mother started a private school in our third story. The scholars were not only the children in our family, Fan, Sue, and myself, but those of our neighbors, so that there were about 8 or 10 of us. That was a great and glorious period during the 1880s. We played and played and had not a care in the world. I remember the death of President James A. Garfield when I was 7. His assassination in July by Guido and his lingering between life and death for 2 months had the whole country so harrowed up that when he finally died on September 19th, 1881, there was a very general and sincere sorrow through the nation. I remember distinctly the picture of Garfield draped in black, hanging back of the pulpit in our church, the old North Unitarian parish of North Andover. It was a very solemn occasion. Mother and cousin May Bullock and I went to Bailey's Beach in Newport for a day's outing. Afterwards, I was very thirsty and drank a lot of water. The next day, we must have started back for North Andover, but all that I remember is that I felt deathly sick on the way home. Reaching home, I was put to bed at once. I became unconscious and knew nothing until about 3 weeks later. I woke up one morning and asked what had happened and was told that I had typhoid fever. I was delirious most of the time, and as I got worse, they were very much afraid that I would not pull through. In the spring of 1888, while I was in high school, we had the famous blizzard that buried the whole East in many feet of snow. Mother took me to spend Sunday with Aunt Eliza and Uncle John Smith in Boston. When we started home on Monday afternoon, it had been snowing for a long time and was blowing hard. By the time the train arrived at Andover, the snow was about a foot and a half deep, with drifts up to 3 feet. Frank Gavin was waiting for us there in our single open sleigh. The roads had not been cleared, and the snow was up to the horses' knees and higher in the drifts. He could not go faster than a walk, and so we started for North Andover. It was not bad in Andover, but out by the Richardson farm, we began to feel the full force of the wind in our faces. And the wind was blowing so hard that the snowflakes felt like needles against our unprotected faces. Passing by Wilson's Corner, the wind blew like fury. The poor horse could only plod slowly along, and it seemed as though we could go no further. But Frank thought we could make it home, as the worst of the unprotected road was behind us, so we kept on. We finally reached the village center and slowly came up the hill by the church, along Prospect Street and into the yard. Mother never got over that experience, and it haunted her for the rest of her life. She would have a smothered feeling as though she was being smothered by snow. Thank you. It was the summer of 1888, and I was getting ready to go to Phillips, Andover, in the fall as a day scholar. Living in commons was a rugged existence, and anyone who survived more than 1 year in them was good for the rest of a long life. The fare that was served was very plain, and not too much of it. There were no bathrooms in the commons. The toilets were the old-fashioned back houses outside of the buildings. The rooms were heated by stoves, the coal for which was stored on the first floor and had to be carried up by each roomer for his own fire. Spring came, and the baseball season started in full swing. The school team, under the leadership of Al Stearns, won most of its games. But as the time approached for the Exeter game, there was a lot of anxiety because it was rumored that Al's pitching arm was in bad shape. The day came, and when Al came on the field, the enthusiasm was unbounded. Al pitched the whole nine innings and struck out man after man so that the Exeter team could get nowhere. On the other hand, neither could our nine. As the game progressed, the excitement grew more intense, so that both schools were cheering every minute of the time. The game finally ended, and Andover had won by the score of 2-1, and Al Stearns was the hero of the hour. I was so hoarse from cheering that I could hardly speak. I began to cough and continued to do so until the doctor said I had the whooping cough, which continued all summer. Summer, 1889, I visited my brother John in Brooklyn, who was living in the clubhouse of the Brooklyn Wheelmen. John and his fellow club members would ride down to Coney Island and hire a bathing suit for a sea bath in the ocean, and then have dinner in Manhattan Beach. After dinner, we would sit around and listen to the band concert, of which the leader was the famous Sousa, reputed to be the tops in band leaders. Of course, it was awfully hot in August, and some evenings we would go to a drugstore up at the corner and have coffee ice cream, which was a new flavor to me and seemed the height of ice cream bliss. At that time, John was riding a high-wheel bicycle, as the so-called safety bicycle had not come into common use. When riding the high-wheel bicycle, if you struck a stone or a rut in the road, the high front wheel would stop, and the small rear wheel would come up, and you would be thrown completely over the handlebars and land on your face in the road. In the early summer, just before graduation, Dr. and Mrs. Bancroft gave their usual reception for the seniors, and this evening affair was supposed to be quite the great event because there were to be many young girls there, and they were a rarity in our young lives. I dressed up in my best and was promptly stage struck and unable to say an intelligent sentence. I had never had anything to do with the female sex. And also I was very bashful with everyone, and always had been. I wandered around the rooms, and joining a boy and a girl, tried to join them in conversation, but made the most painful entry with an inane remark. I saw them look at each other and suppress a smile, whereupon I left them and left the house, going back to my room in deep mortification. I never let on to Mother about it, but I was sunk in deep depression. From Mother's photographs, she was a lovely-looking young woman, and have no doubt that Father fell very much in love with her. Father and Mother were married on March 27, 1873. On August 3rd, 1874, I was born and given Father's name. From my pictures, I was fat and round-faced, the usual run of a baby except when I was hungry because of my Stephen's stomach. In April 1876, some member of his family came down with scarlet fever, and that dread disease rapidly spread to the other members until all six of the children were in bed with it. While the children were recovering, Father contracted the disease and became very sick. Dr. Kittredge worked very hard over Father, but to no avail, so that on May 1st, 1876, he passed away. This was a terrible shock to Mother, faced with the future bringing up of six children. A week or two before Father was stricken with scarlet fever, he wrote Mother a beautiful note of his deep affection for her. The fact that Mother kept it all her life showed only too clearly that she treasured it dearly. I have no doubt that this letter and the memory of their 3 years of happy married life were the staffs on which she leaned, and which gave her courage during the many cares and problems with which she was faced during the 30 years. The 30 years. The 30 years. Thank you. following Father's death. I remember. I remember. I remember.